ببسم الله نبدأ بالكلام وبحمد الله هو مسخ الختام ثم الصلاة الله في أبهى السلام على طه المظلل بالغمام السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. From time to time I will be adding some supplemental resources for people that are following this subject, especially those of you who are studying it with me in person. And a question that was recently brought up to my attention was like on the idea of the fa'ida of usul al-fiqh, like what are the virtues of usul al-fiqh related to like our current situation. And that caused me to remember a book that really set with me for 4 years. In Al-Azhar, usul al-fiqh is so important that you take it in two courses for 4 years. You, at that time, we took it four times a week. So two were related to like a classical text, Nihayat al-Suhul of Sayyidina Imam al-Isnawi, Ada Minhaj of Sayyidina Imam al-Baydawi, and then of course a book that was written by our professors. So you did this for 4 years in the university for the non-Hanafis. Hanafis, they have also their own program. And so I remember, you know, my first year I sat down after finishing high school and we started to study this book, Nihayat al-Suhul. I didn't even know what Sul meant. I just knew what Nihaya meant from Imam al-Isnawi, from Isna. The only Isna I knew was Isna, you know, the organization in America. And I remember all of us sitting together as students and just being completely like, ma fahimna ayyashay. Like we were lost, right? And so I began to ask some of the teachers that I was sitting with and studying with, like, is there something I can do? Because this is like a whole different world. Right? And they directed me to this book, mashallah, Usul al-Fiqh by Ustaz Dr. Al-Alama Muhammad Abu Nur Zuhayir, rahimahullah. Muhammad Abu Nur Zuhayir died in 1987. So يعتبر شيخ شيوخنا, right? Like he's the teacher of many of our teachers. And he actually wrote this book as a Maliki, right? To encapsulate a lot of things that sometimes are lost and not mentioned from the Maliki Usul, but as like Mawsu'a Ilmiya Usuliya, right? It really touches on everything, and you can see actually it's a four-volume book. This is the best print by Darb al-Sa'ir in Egypt, which is behind the Azhar in Darb al-Atraq, because Dr. Muhammad al-Sayyid and others were his students, like they read to him. But anyways, what I thought we would do is just read from his section at the very beginning, and I actually teach this book in the fifth year at Swiss to people who are like interested in really going into like a deeper study of usul al-fiqh. So the sheikh, he says, وَقَالَ رَحِيمُهُ اللَّهُ, I'm going to read it in Arabic and English for students, right? فَإِدَةُ أُصُول الفقه. يعني هذه فائدة أُصُول الفقه. The virtues of أُصُول الفقه. And even though he used the word فائدة, it means plural. Because we say إضافة المفرد تفيد الجمع, right? That sometimes you may use a singular possessive, but it means plural. Like بسم الله actually means بأسماء الله. So Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. It doesn't say نِعْمَ اللَّهِ. Like if you wanted to count, نِعْمَ is like the blessing of God. But because it's مُضَاف, مُضَافٌ إِلَيْهِ, فَهِمْنَا مِنْ هَذَا التَّرْكِيبِ إِضَافَةُ الْمُفْرَدِ تُفِيدُ الْجَمْعَ. فَقَالَ رَحِيمُهُ اللَّهِ لِأُصُولِ فِقْهِ فَائِدَةً. The Shaykh, he says, mashallah, that there are two, you know, virtues of studying usul al-fiqh. Doesn't mean that these are the only two, but he's going to mention two which he felt are important. إحداهما ترجع إلى المجتهد نفسه. The first is one that deals with the actual mujtahid. وهو من يستنبط الأحكام الفقهية من الأدلة التفصيلية. And then, of course, he defines who is a mujtahid, is the one who can extract fiqh rulings from the evidences of fiqh, right? The detailed evidences of fiqh. So, for example, when I was in Dar Ifta, and at that time we were reading Al-Minhaj, taban madhhab Shafi'i, by reading al-Minhaj to Dr. Muhammad Rafat Uthman. MashaAllah. Hada shams kan yajri ala wajh al-ard. And he passed away, you know, subhanAllah, a few years ago. I have never seen somebody like him in my life when it came to humility and simplicity, but then just this massive amount of knowledge, mashallah. Wallah alhamdulillah akramani rabbi an aqra alayh. I used to be scared like in front of him because he was, mashallah, so much like heba and so simplistic, mashallah. But anyways, at that time in Masr, there was a big issue when I was there, the paternity case related to a famous person. And there was this big discussion about, you know, him being the father of somebody and him denying it. And then, of course, the mother claiming he was the father. And then there was this issue about using DNA. This is a long time ago, so bear with me. And it came to Dara Ifta, and it came to Dr. Muhammad Rafat in our class. He brought it up and asked us, like, let's practice. Like, let's engage this issue. Of course, we didn't know anything, you know? Pardon the double negative. Like, who the heck are we? You're Dr. Muhammad Rafat Uthman. فكنا نخاف يعني كال 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 كالشاء أمام الجزار يوم النحر. So Sheikh, he engaged us, like he led us through this discussion. And he said, well, you know, my answer is found in Sultan Yusuf. I said, how is that possible, Sultan Yusuf? DNA? He said, DNA is تعتبر قرينة. Right, DNA is like a secondary issue used to prove a point. So he said, I have thought about this greatly and have extracted that if the shirt of Yusuf could be used as secondary evidence to either sustain his guilt or prove his innocence, وقياسنا على ذلك, then we can use DNA. هذا هو المجتهد يعني. هذا ما يستنبط الأحكام من أدلة الشريعة التفصيلية. This is an example of someone now who made ijtihad. الله يرحمه. I'm sure many of you are thinking, well, باب الاجتهاد مغلق ومش عارف ايه كلام كتير. Inshallah, be patient, man. It'll come later. وثانيهما ترجع إلى المقلد. Right? And then the second benefit of أصول الفقه is related to the person who does not have enough knowledge to extract rulings, so they have to follow specialists. What taqlid is to take the opinion of someone bidun ma'rifat al-dalil, without knowing the evidences. And Sheikh, he says, وَهُوَ مَنْ يَأْخُذُ تِلْكَ الْأَحْكَامَ مِنَ الْمُجْتَهِدِ وَيَكُونُ عَلَى بَيِّنَةٍ مِنْ هَذَا الْفَنِ. So the muqalid is the one who takes the rulings, not from the adilla, but from the ulama. And here we learn something very important. أقوال العلماء عند المقلدين كأدلة التفصيلية عند المجتهدين. This is a very important axiom that I learned from one of my teachers. أقوال العلماء عند المقلدين كالأدلة التفصيلية عند المجتهدين. Right, so what's an obligation on a person who doesn't know is to ask, not to know the reasons why. We're going to talk about this later on, because that's beyond their study. It's like asking someone about, you know, the architecture to build your home, or asking them about something related to now, like the vaccine, or something related to, you know, any type of higher science that you and I haven't spent years studying, and then suddenly expecting ourselves to know how they came to those conclusions without respecting their effort and their investment. And this is something that has thrown off the rails of the Sunni Muslim community, that in aqidah, taqlidu la yajuz. It's not allowed to make taqlid in aqidah, because we are all responsible for believing in Allah. But in the secondary issues, what is an obligation is to ask and follow those people who know, issues of fiqh. But now, subhanAllah, we see people making taqlid in aqidah, and then everyone is the ijtihad in fiqh. This has kind of reversed the trend of what was the mainstream Sunni positions on many issues. Wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah. But remember this axiom, inshallah, and this is not our purpose now, but we're going to discuss it in the future, inshallah. أقوال العلماء أو أراء العلماء أو المجتهدين عند المقلدين كأدلة تفصيلية عند المجتهدين. And some of the things that I'm telling you, I heard from people. Sometimes people ask, what book did you get that from? What book? Some of the stuff, alhamdulillah, I heard from my teachers. So I'm trying, like at times, to source that information. But if it's not, I'm going to tell you. هكذا سمعت من أفوام الشيوخ. This is what I heard from different people. And this axiom I just mentioned from Dr. Muhammad Wissam. أقوال المجتهدين عند المقلدين كالأدلة التفصيلية عند المجتهدين. SubhanAllah. So he says basically that the fa'id of usul al-fiqh are two. One goes back to the mujtahid, the other goes back to the muqalid. قال أما الأولى فهي قدرته على استنباط الأحكام من الأدلة. So as to the first, the benefit to the mujtahid is that it's going to provide him or her the ability to extract rulings from the evidences. فَإِنَّ الْمُجْتَهِدَ مَتَى كَانَ عَالِمًا بِأَحْوَالِ الْأَدِلَّةِ الْكُلِّيَّةِ. Because when someone has knowledge and scholarship related to the general evidences, مِثْلُ عِلْمِهِ بِأَنَّ الْأَمْرَ لِلْوُجُوبِ إِذَا لَمْ تَقُنْ قَرِينَةٌ عَلَى خِلَافِ ذَلِكَ. For example, he or she would know that a command means an obligation unless there is, you know, something to negate that it's an obligation. We'll talk about this in Usul al-Fiqh. وَأَنَّ النَّهْيَ لِلتَّحْرِيمِ مَا لَمْ تَقُنْ قَرِينَةٌ عَلَى الْكِرَاهَةِ. And that, you know, something which is telling us not to do something implies that it's forbidden unless there's an evidence that weakens it to be like makruh, disliked. إِسْتِطَاعَ أي الْمُجْتَهِدُ يَسْتَطِعَ أن يستنبط وجوب الصلاة من قوله تعالى بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وأقيم الصلاة. So when a scholar knows this, he or she will be able to understand that when Allah says أقيم الصلاة, أقيم is an order, so it means that صلاة is an obligation. وتحريم الزنا أي يستنبط يعني حكم تحريم الزنا من قوله تعالى ولا تقربوا الزنا. And that he'll understand, or she'll understand, that adultery and fornication are forbidden because Allah says, you're not allowed, you're forbidden to come close to zina. فَيَقُولُ أَيْ فَيَقُولُ هَذَا الْمُجْتَهِدُ أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ أَمْرٌ. That moment the scholar is going to say, you know, أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ is an order. وَالْأَمْرُ لِلْوُجُوبِ. This is a famous axiom, I'm going to teach it to you soon. وَالْأَمْرُ لِلْوُجُوبِ. And a command means obligation. فَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ لِلْوُجُوبِ. So therefore, establishing prayer is wajib, fard. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا زِنَا نَهْيٌ. And don't come close to adultery or fornication is a prohibition. وَنَهْيُ لِلْتَحْرِيمِ. This is another axiom. النَّهْيُ لِلْتَحْرِيمِ. And if you pay attention here, you're going to see the عَلَقَ بَيْنَ مَعْرِفَةِ اللُّغَةِ وَمَعْرِفَةِ أُصُولِ الْفِقْهِ. Right, the relationship between language and usul al-fiqh. أن يعرف أقيم من أفعل. Right, ويعرف لا تقربوا ولا هذا لا نهي لأن النون محذوفة لا تقربوا. So at that moment he is understanding what this means in the language, and then he marries that what's called المقدمة الثانية. فمقدمة الأولى معرفة اللغة والمقدمة الثانية معرفة الأصول والنتيجة حكم. So three steps: understanding Arabic, understanding أصول الفقه, and then the ruling. So ما شاء الله أقيم الصلاة, right? You have to establish the صلاة. أفعل is a command. لا تقرب الزنا is a command للترك. So both are commands to do and not to do. And then the principles of usul, al-amr al-wujub, wal-nahyu lit-tahrim, fala taqrabu zina lit-tahrimi. So then one is an obligation and one means zina, forbidden. فَقَالَ الشَّيْخ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ شَيْخَ أَبُو نُورِ فَالْمُقَدِّمَةُ الْأُولَى فِي كُلِّ مِنْ دَلِيلَيْنِ يَعْلَمُهَا أَيْ يَعْلَمُهَا الْمُجْتَهِدُ مِنَ اللُّغَةِ كَمَا قُلْتُ. Right, so the Shaykh, he says, the first, what's called al-muqaddimat al-ula. Inshallah, in the future, we can learn these things. From both dalils, يَعْلَمُهَا الْمُجْتَهِدُ مِنَ اللُّغَةِ. The scholar, the mujtahid, understands this, knows this from the language. وَالْمُقَدِّمَةُ الثَّانِيَةُ فِي كُلِّ مِنْهُمَا يَعْلَمُهَا الْمُجْتَهِدْ مِنَ الْأُصُولِ. As I said earlier, and then the second part of this was called مُقَدِّمَة الثَّانِيَة, which is the principle, the axiom of usul, also informs the scholar, so he knows this from usul. So, الْأَمْرُ للوجوب أقيم الصلاة أمر والأمر للوجوب بمعنى أن إقامة الصلاة واجب فرض لا تقربوا زنا لا نهي لأن تقربوا من أفعال الخمسة وحذفت النون ها أن لن إذن كي لا مكي ولا مجحود آسف من الجوازم فلا تقربوا حذفت النون لأن ما يسمى لا نهي لا تقربوا لنهي والنهي للتحريم إذن زنا محرم. So you see that process, language, أصل, نتيجة, language, أصول, نتيجة, language, أصول, نتيجة. That's why one of my teachers used to say, he's in prison, may Allah free him, معرفة اللغة نصف أصول الفقه. سبحان الله. ولولا معرفته لأصول الفقه ما استطاع أن يستنبط هذين الحكمين. And so if that scholar didn't know these things, didn't know أصول الفقه, he or she would not be able to extract the ruling. فأصول الفقه جعله قادرا على استنباط هذين الحكمين. And this is the فائدة. جعله قادرا على استنباط. So the first virtue is that it allows someone who has mastery of this science to have the ability to extract rulings. من دليلهما ومثل ذلك يقال في غيرهما من الأحكام. And so on and so forth from different rulings. وأما الثانية أي الفائدة الثانية طبعا عند الكوفيين الألف لام represents something which is محذوفة أي وأما الفائدة الثانية. How do we know that الفائدة is not mentioned but it's there? Is because الثانية has تا مربوطة. وأما الثانية فهي جعل المقلد الذي درس هذا الفن على بينة مما فعله إمامه عند استنباطه للأحكام. So the second is for the muqalid, that he or she is going to have greater conviction in the opinions of the imams and teachers who have extracted rulings and guidance for them. فإن المقلد متى وقف على طرق الأئمة وما ذهب إليه كل منهما بنسبة لتلك القواعد الأصولية اطمأنت نفسه إلى مدرك إمامه بالنسبة للحكم الذي قلده فيه. More or less what I just said, that when the muqallid is able to look at the different evidences and ideas of the imams and the opinions that they've taken and the relationship between those things and the foundations of usul, they're going to find conviction and ease in their heart towards the opinions that their teachers have taken. فَيَدْعُوهُ ذَٰلِكَ إِلَى الطَّاعَةِ وَالْإِمْتِثَالِ. And this is going to strengthen now the resolve of the person and increase their obedience, right, and submission and passion for devotion.
وَيَكُونُ عِنْدَهُ الْقُدْرَةِ الَّتِي تَمَكَّنَهُ مِنَ الدِّفَاعِ عَنْ وِجْهَةِ إِمَامِهِ فِي مَا اسْتَنْبَطَهُ مِنَ الْأَحْكَامِ.
And also, and this is not talking about with the Muslims. This is talking about in the face of, say, the Orientalists. You see really aggressive work happening in France. You see even some Muslim thinkers succumbing to the supremacy of the West and its criticism of Islam. This is going to equip the person with tools to be able to defend themselves and defend the positions that their teachers have taken. And that's why if you take fiqh with me, at Swiss, fiqh Maliki, I teach it with the evidences in the Usul. That's why. And subhanAllah, here years ago, I wrote a note. I don't know if you can see there.
وَلَعَلَّ أُضِيفُ إِلَى ذَٰلِكَ فَائِدَةٌ أُخْرَى.
I wrote, and maybe, perhaps, we can add another benefit to this.
وَهُوَ.
And that benefit is
تَأْلِيفُ الْأُمَّةِ وَوَحْدَتِهَا.
That when we understand a little bit of Usul al-Fiqh, not necessarily the scholarly level, like this book is like, it's subhanAllah, man. It's no joke. But we'll be able to equalize and bring much needed unity and harmony to our community. So alhamdulillah, you know, like if we see people arguing over issues that we know are secondary issues related to Usul that have been extracted by scholars, then alhamdulillah, like we're going to tell people you don't need to fight over this issue. Unfortunately, we see most people fighting over issues which they shouldn't even fight over. Or we find this need to always declare who's right and wrong. So hyper-takfirism, like Usul al-Fiqh will deal with that. We have the famous axiom, La takfira bi iqamat al-ihtimal, right? You can't make takfir of someone if there's a chance that they're not kafir, that they're still Muslim. So in spite of all the, you know, the statements people are going to bring from this scholar, Thawri, this Shaykh, Imams, Rahimahumullah, Jami'an, all the aqwal of the imma have to be understood on the umbrella of the qawa'id usuliyyah. La takfira bi iqamat al-ihtimal. This is a famous axiom found in usul, that there's no takfir if there's a probability that someone is still Muslim. Imagine how much trouble this would have solved on online and on Facebook and on this and that and that and amongst some of our mashallah passionate brothers and sisters. So alhamdulillah, we mentioned three of the virtues of studying usul al-fiqh, mashallah. The first, tarji'u ila al-mujtahid. The second, tarji'u ila al-muqalid. And the third, tarji'u ila al-muqalid wa ila al-ummah. Right? So the third goes back to the muqalid and also the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu feekum. Inshallah, I'll try to, from time to time, post some supplemental information that I hope will help you. Ask Allah to bless you and to increase you. Jazakum Allahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.